On today's program, my wife Benedicta and I are going to show you how to make a fantastic Mexican-style breakfast that should barely raise your blood sugar. If you've recently been diagnosed with diabetes and you've just discovered this channel, let me recommend that you go to our uploads page, which will give you access to every diabetic video we've posted since we began. As you work your way through all our videos, I believe you'll find the help you need. A link to our uploads page is in the description. Well, welcome to Beat Diabetes, and I am happy to have a very beautiful and lovely assistant who happens to be my wife, Benedicta. Say hello to everybody.
Hello, everybody.
We sort of have a feeling of deja vu doing this.
Yes.
Because this is not the first time we have done this particular food. We're going to show you a great recipe.
Right.
We did this years ago.
We did it years ago.
Before we were ever on YouTube.
Right.
And we were just trying to make some videos about diabetes and help some people learn some things. We were going to put together a little package, and YouTube was the last thing on my mind. Never even thought about it.
Mm-mm.
Hardly watched any YouTube videos.
Hardly. Don't watch TV.
No, don't watch TV too much, but in the evenings with you, I will.
Yes.
In the daytime, I don't. But anyway, you watch some YouTube. Before then,
right.
I watched almost no YouTube. Once in a while, I might run across something, but I did. I have to admit, I wasn't really into YouTube in those days.
Almost everybody watched everything.
Yeah, I know. I was living in the prehistoric days, I guess.
Just you. I don't know where you've been.
But we made something called Chile Rellenos Huevos. Which is a mouthful to say, especially for a non-Hispanic.
I don't even want to try.
No, don't even try it.
Mm-mm.
But I got that recipe from a fella named George Stella.
Okay.
And that's a little easier to pronounce.
Yeah.
When I first went low carb and realized I had to slash the carbs, I was desperate for foods to eat, recipes to try, stuff to eat. It's like, I know I can't eat this, I can't eat that, I can't eat this, I can't eat that. What can I eat? What can I eat? I'm saying.
I don't know. You can't eat all everything.
So in those days, it's not that I didn't watch YouTube. There was no YouTube in those days. That was like 2002.
Mm.
I started having my blood sugar problems in 2001. 2002, just had no idea. So I could read books. And mostly I got my info from Richard Bernstein, Dr. Mm-hmm. Richard Bernstein.
Right.
And Dr. Richard Atkins. And I learned some things from them. But in terms of foods I could eat, I just wasn't sure. And then I ran across a fellow named George Stella who had a program on the Food Channel.
Mm.
I don't know if he still does. I don't think he does, but he's got a big website. I think it's called stellalife.com. I'll put it on the screen. Big website. And he's written a lot of books. So anyway, I got different foods. You know, it's like I couldn't eat pancakes. And then Stella showed me how I could eat pancakes.
Mm.
And I couldn't eat blueberry muffins, which I loved blueberry muffins. And then George Stella told me how I could have blueberry muffins and keep it low carb. So this particular recipe comes from George Stella.
Okay.
And we used it. We learned about it. We started making this. We enjoyed it.
Yes.
And so, like I said, I made it once before, but I've never put it on YouTube. So this is our YouTube version of this particular recipe.
Mm.
And it's kind of a Mexican breakfast.
Yes.
So let me ask you, what makes Mexican food Mexican? What does it have to officially be Mexican food, or at least have a bit of a feel of Mexican food?
Well, Mexican food has a lot of carbohydrates, tortilla shell has to be there, you know, some carbohydrates has to be in there. And another thing, it has to be hot, like the sauce, hot sauce has to be in there. And then, you know, you're getting Mexican real food, real Mexican food. And I kind of love it.
Well, Americans love Mexican food. I mean, there's Mexican restaurants everywhere.
Right.
People make Mexican food in their homes.
Yes.
And there's a reason for that. It's good. It tastes good.
It's good.
But for the diabetic, the problem is not really the hot sauce. You know, hot sauce we can pretty much handle. The problem are all those flatbreads like tortillas and enchiladas, all that kind of stuff that's got a lot of white flour or corn flour.
A lot.
Just not so good. So if you can find something that gives you at least the taste of Mexican, but doesn't give you all the carbs, you're good. And that's what this does.
Right.
So basically what we're going to make today is a muffin that has zero flour.
Zero flour.
No corn, no wheat, no grain of any kind.
Mm.
So it's essentially an egg muffin. And it comes in three stages, really. So we're going to do stage one, put it in the oven, come back, talk to you about stage two, and then stage three. Stage four is to eat and enjoy.
A lot of stages.
A lot of stages. This is not something you're going to make for yourself when you've got 5 minutes to have breakfast and get out of there and go to work. This is something you're going to need about a good 30 minutes to make.
The day you are going nowhere, you can just sit and get everything together and prepare it. Yeah.
Saturday morning, where you just have
Not Sunday
bit of
morning,
time.
We'll go to church.
Well, these days we don't
these
so
days
much.
These days we don't too much.
But in the old days, and hopefully soon when this COVID
soon
thing
is over.
Soon
the churches will open.
The churches are going to open up. So we're going to start with this stuff right here, which is sausage. It's actually called Polish kielbaska, I believe it is, or Polska kielbaska. I don't know. I'm probably saying that wrong, but it's basically sausage. And my love, I'm going to have you to cut that into fairly small pieces and put it in our muffin pan and show them how to do it.
Step number one is to cut the sausage into small chunks and place them in the muffin holes until they come about halfway up. It will take slightly less than half of a sausage to make six muffins. Then crack an egg over each muffin and leave it alone. You don't have to stir the egg or do anything to it. Just crack it, drop it in the muffin container, and you're done.
Right.
And we have almost finished stage one.
Stage one is over.
Stage one. Isn't that exciting?
Right.
So what are we going to do with this little creation?
We'll just take this as it is down into the oven.
Right. And our oven is downstairs. It's not this oven here. This is a fake oven, but we got a real oven downstairs. So we're going
to... We are giving up all our secrets. Like, this is oven.
Yeah, that's our oven number two.
Oven number two.
You've heard of fake news. That's a fake oven.
Oven number one is where this is going into.
Right, this is going into oven number one. So we'll see you back in a little bit. It'll take about 18 minutes. We're going to cook it at 375 for 18 minutes. We'll come back and show you stage number two. So stage one is complete.
Complete.
Isn't that exciting?
Exciting.
Actually, we had a couple little glitches, I guess you could call them.
Ah.
Glitch number one, we forgot to spray the pan. Normally, you'd want to spray the pan. But I sort of cheated and checked to see if these eggs are going to come out. Looks like they will, so I think we're okay. This particular type of muffin pan works pretty good for that. Glitch number two.
I think any pan will work.
Maybe. Glitch number two is that we had set the oven for 18 minutes at 375. They weren't done, were they?
Uh-uh.
You noticed it right away, didn't you?
Right.
And if there's one thing this lady does not like, it's eggs that aren't done.
Mm-mm.
I'll never forget the time we went to a restaurant and they served you a couple of fried eggs. They were just as runny as could possibly be.
Runny eggs.
And she was not at all happy.
Uh-uh.
And so you told the waitress you'd like her to bring some more.
Please, can you take it back?
Or make them a little better done.
Yes.
So she brought them back. And what was the result?
She made a new batch of egg and brought them back.
Yeah.
And I kind of cut it. The thing went runny all over the place. I'm like, my mom didn't really raise me with runny eggs. Dennis, can you eat this, please?
The waitress brought the eggs back, and they looked exactly like the first two eggs.
They
were just as runny as ever, and so I ended up eating, I think, four eggs instead of two. Anyway, these are not runny now. We ended up cooking them or baking them for 18 plus an extra 23 minutes, and now I think they have met your satisfaction, right?
Well, yeah, they're done.
Okay. So, stage two And Benedict is going to put some of the chilies and some cheese. And we left the oven on because...
we're taking this right back into the oven after putting all that.
Back into the oven, but this time just for 1 minute, just long enough to melt that cheese and let it drizzle all over the whole creation.
All of it.
So we're living dangerously because we've got these diced green chilies, and one of them is mild, which is kind of what we normally do. One of them is hot, so living dangerously.
Yeah.
Well, not for me. For Nigerians, hot, that's just normal.
Yep.
And I'll never forget some of the soups I've eaten in Nigeria.
Very hot.
So hot, my scalp almost catches on fire.
Your scalp!
I'll never forget the gari and the soup we had in Nigeria one time. The gari, which is a doughy substance made of what, cassava?
Gari, yeah, cassava.
Yeah, gari. If you don't know what gari is, well, it tastes good, actually. But they didn't bring a spoon, so I had to eat it with my hands, which I didn't mind so much. I can do that. I'm enough of a Nigerian now that I can do that. But it was so hot. So it was physically hot, temperature-wise. It was, the soup was spicy hot in terms of spices. It was just hot, hot, hot.
Hot, hot, hot. We like our food hot. And
yeah.
As you are eating it, you are sweating from your head. Every Nigerian will tell you that. Serve the food hot.
And
sweating from the head to the top.
When a Nigerian woman has a baby, they bring her special soup for
helping her recover. Ah, you don't want to go there.
And that's even hotter still.
Hey.
it's the absolute hottest you could imagine. All right, let's go ahead. Put the chilies on first.
The first step of stage two is quite simple. Add a liberal amount of diced chilies to the top of the muffin, mild or hot as you prefer. After that, cover the muffin with a generous amount of shredded cheese. The more, the merrier.
Looks great. Kind of tilt it toward our camera so they can see what it looks like at this point.
Okay.
But don't spill it all out.
That.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we are going to stick that back in the oven for 1 minute only.
One minute.
And that'll melt that cheese, and then we'll be ready to take it out and go to stage three.
Stage three.
This is getting more and more exciting as we go, isn't it?
Right?
I mean, I just can't stand it.
Yeah.
All right.
Stage by stage. Yeah.
We will be back with stage three.
We'll be right back.
Well, our egg muffins are back. We have entered finally into stage three.
Stage three.
Stage three. We've got the cheese melted. We've got the diced little chilies on there.
On there.
And stage three just gives it a little extra Mexican boost.
Yep.
And that is, we're going to put some sour cream. You like sour cream?
I like sour cream.
Yeah, I think it's good. And it has very few carbs.
Right.
And then some taco, picante sauce, which... it probably has more carbs than any other single ingredient, but still, it's not that bad.
Right.
We should be able to handle it.
For this final stage in making the Mexican egg muffins, put about a tablespoon of sour cream over the muffins, and then add about another tablespoon of picante sauce. Now, this step could be left out, and the muffins would still be good, but I think the sour cream and the picante sauce turns them from good to great.
Well, at last, our creation is done. I think we've created a masterpiece. What do you think?
We created a masterpiece. I agree with that.
So, we've got on this side the egg muffins with the diced chilies that are hot, and this side are the mild. So, we're going to take a taste of each and see how they seem.
Yeah.
So, what's your verdict, mild versus hot? Did you like one more than the other? Like them both equally? What do you think?
I like them both equally. If you like, you know, something spicy, you go for this. If you like something mild, you go for this. But I like them equally.
Okay. I actually think I preferred the hot chilies over the mild.
He's a real Nigerian, right?
Well, and real Nigerian, real Mexican, you know, you got to have a little spice in life. Why do you think I married you, you know, if not to add some spice to my life?
About that. Pay no attention to that.
So, the hot chilies, they're not too hot. They didn't knock me down or anything like that.
No.
But they add a little extra spice. So, but they're both good. They're both absolutely good. So, give this a shot and see how you like it. Well, just a quick report on these jazzed up egg muffins and how they affected our blood sugar. Our tests revealed exactly what I suspected they would. There was little effect on our glucose. At the 1 hour post-meal mark, the time when my glucose levels normally peak,
My blood sugar went from 107 pre-meal to 109 post-meal, which, given the margin of error with blood sugar meters, is essentially no rise at all. I ate 2 muffins, but Benedict was a little hungrier than I was, and she ate 3. She had a 104 glucose reading before the meal and a 111 reading 1 hour after eating. So for her, there was a tiny little rise, but not much. What this means is that these Mexican-style egg muffins are Mike-approved. Mike the blood sugar meter tells us that when we eat these muffins, we will get very little blood sugar spike. Now, you may notice that I'm using a different meter than I have in quite a while. I read somewhere that the Contour Next glucose meters are one of the most accurate of the blood sugar meters. So I thought I'd switch and give them a try. But one thing that kind of bugged me is that they read about 12 to 15 points higher than the Freestyle Precision Neo meters I have been using. Now, I'd like to think that the Freestyle meter was the most accurate, but who knows? At least with the higher readings that this Contour Next meter gives me, I'm more motivated to keep my carbs a little bit lower. So, this is Dennis and
Benedicta
saying God bless and hope you enjoy this breakfast.
Thanks for watching. Don't forget to subscribe, like it, and leave your comments below.